Submittal. This submittal register is where you're going to see that. Once you link the schedule items to the open submittal, submittal items, the submittal register will be filled out. There's five or six columns in the middle. It says submittal needed by, approval needed by, this by, yada yada. It'll fill out those blanks as soon as you link those up. That's where you'll find it. Also, in order to link those submittals to the schedule activities, I suggest you print that, the submittal register here, and go on the right-hand column over there and sit down with your project manager or the scheduler and hand write in exactly what the schedule activity. It should be the first activity of the schedule that's pertaining to that. So if it's rough and electrical, and you're going to start the first floor rough and electrical in area A first, that's the activity that should be synced to it, not the last activity in that sequence of rough. It should be the first one, because all the submittals should be done by the time you get the first one done. So unless you break them down into specific areas, then you might link them to the activity, appropriate activity. But anyway, most of the submittal stuff should be done before the first activity starts. Next, the next one here is the schedule one. Current activity schedule, project calendar. The project calendar is a really pretty cool calendar. It starts, it does proceed as day zero. And you can look down the line and then and any day of the contract, it will tell you what calendar day of your contract you're on. The last one there is activities with start and finish dates since the previous schedule. This is the one that will get you in trouble if your scheduler is not reviewing this report when he's doing his monthly update. You need to run this report and give this to the scheduler. And as the scheduler status and schedule, he needs to use the actual start dates that the QC used. Okay? As long as the QC's right. Otherwise, you need to get the QC's changed and get the scheduler's right. You know, the schedule's right. So this is the report you want to run. Now, what happens sometimes is the QC might not know everything that the superintendent's actually working on. Okay? Yeah, he's supposed to know everything that's happening on the job. The superintendent ran over there and started an activity with a crew that he had available, and the QC didn't really know that was happening today because he's already had his day planned out. He's working on the other side of the building. So some of that, sometimes that's going to happen. Some activities that come up that they should have had a start date on the daily report, and they didn't. And that's okay if the schedule brings those in. But the ones that the QC actually logged in, you better make sure those sync with what the schedule says and what the QC report says. So, next. And this is that project calendar. Like I said, it's pretty cool because if you acknowledge NTP on November the 3rd, that's day zero, so that you can pick any day of the contract and say, okay, this is calendar day number 141, and we're at March 24th, or whatever it is. So this is a pretty neat little feature, nice little calendar. And as mods come, it'll actually update. If we give you a mod, it'll update to the TCP and the contractor part. Okay, on to the pay application in Primavera. If you are using Primavera P3, you will have to go browse your CD and get the SDEF utility off of the CD. It'll be on there. If you are using Primavera P6, you are going to have to call the company, Oracle, and have them tell you what to do to get an SDF utility onto P6. I don't know the answer to that. I haven't got it loaded, but if you don't know how it works in P3, here's the steps. I know how to do it. P6 is a new beast, and we're using it, and we're kind of embracing it. Yeah, P7, P6 points, whatever. They keep changing and upgrading, and I can't keep up. I mean, they'll change stuff to you're like, that's crazy. But we're embracing it, and if you're going to use it, or if your company has decided you're going to use P6 and stuff like that, don't try to convert the job back to a P3 job because it just messes it up. If you're using P6, then submit us everything in P6 format. If you're using P3, submit it to us in P3 format. Don't try to convert between the two because that creates problems when you try to convert between the two. So, next, basically under P3, here's your folder. You can pull the SDF utility, tell it to run it. It's an XCE file. You install it, go ahead and set up. Then it puts it under Primavera P3. There will be a P3 SDF utility right there below. And that's what you use to convert your job and import into QCS and do your pay application. real simple in P3. P6, I'm not real sure everything about that. Also, back to the RMS website. Here's information about P3. They have some utility stuff. You can go look at it. And we're under user guides again, because here's that Excel template we were at before. Here's the P6 information. It says right here, or SDF contact portal. So good luck getting a hold of those guys and getting them to help you out, but you got to contact Oracle for that. And then also, here's some SDES stuff. It just gives you some more utility. It gives you a utility and some other things, just some other examples stuff to help you out. The primary feature, or the primary thing that you have to do, there are a couple things that you have to do in the schedule every single time if you want to import and work with QCS. First of all, your activity code structure has to be set up properly. Okay? In P3, it's very simple. There is a activity code structure, and it's set up on a schedule-by-schedule basis. And it's very simple. You go and put in the activity code just like they're called out here, and it all works just fine. On P6, they have a global, they have a global level, they have a project level, they have this level and this level, and it's all these options and stuff. If you're going to use P6, you have to set it to project level in order to work with us. You cannot go global level because it overwrites our stuff every time with your corporate stuff. So it gets nuts. So if you want to talk about P6, we'll talk about that offline later. Anyway. This is the code structure. You have to use WRKP. It has to be a link to 3. RESP, responsibility, has to be a link to 4. Area work, link to 4. Modification, 6. Down the line. BDE is your plans. You will have to do this exact format in this exact order, in the exact spaces. Now, if you want to import into QCS. Now this, sometimes contractors, like that example I was giving you, doing the 03200-1, that'll keep all your characters in the first 10, so basically these are wasted spaces, but you got to take them up. You will still have about 8 open characters at the end that if you wanted to run an update code, or if you're using a scheduling firm and they run update codes or something like that, you can actually add 8 below that after you set these up. But if these aren't right, you will never get off the first page. Or you won't even get to hit the ball because they won't let you go up to the line until you get these right. The second item is your cleans have to be balanced and your cleans have to be in sync every single time. So if we give you a modification, if it's a notice to proceed on a price change order, and we send you a notice to proceed that says here's another $30,000, you may not be in agreement with us on what the cost of this change is yet. If we give you a notice to proceed, you're going to have to put an activity in your schedule for that $30,000, and you're going to have to do it unless you don't want to get paid this month, because it won't import until you do it. So it's the schedule is very dynamic, and we expect it to be kept up to date and that kind of stuff. Okay? Also, okay, we already talked about the cleanse. It is imperative on every single schedule you ever give us, the preliminary, the initial, the monthly updates, that the cleans are balanced. Now, on your preliminary schedule, if you read the scheduling spec, it says you shall turn in a schedule within 15 days of notice to proceed. What do we expect out of that schedule? Well, we expect the first 90 days to be detailed enough to where we can make payment to you. We want you to get your money as fast as possible. We're not trying to penalize you. We don't want to hold your money. We don't want any of that. We want you to get your schedule done because it's very important to us. So we want first 90 days detailed, and then we want the remainder of the job, and it's recommended, it's not a mandatory thing, but it's recommended that you summarize the remainder of the job by responsibility code. Okay, and you're like, well, I didn't buy them out yet. Well, remember the examples I just gave you earlier? You don't have to buy them out. You basically know if you're going to do a building, you're going to have an electrician, you're going to have a mechanical guy, you're going to have a roofer, you're going to have a plumber, you're going to have a this, you're going to have a that. So do generic codes, MEC8, ELEC. That kind of stuff, and summarized by that. You put your estimated dollar values on that. You give me a quick preliminary schedule. It may be 50 activities. It may be 20 activities. I don't know, whatever it takes to get you that detailed, depending on the complexity of your job. We approve that. We start making you monthly payments, okay? You'll have bond broke out so we can get your payment. You know, the first 30 days, you got your bond payment, you're moving on. So we'll keep paying dependence on that while you're expanding the initial schedule. Your initial schedule should take your preliminary and then expand upon that. So you don't go delete activities out of your preliminary, you expand them. So you can change dollars, you can change descriptions, all that kind of stuff, and don't go delete them. After you've imported it, it keeps track of where they're at. So that's basically my spiel about schedules. If you want to talk about that in any depth further, or your project manager wants to talk about that in depth further, have them call me. Or we have another scheduler up there, Bob Wyland, and we are more than happy to help y'all get your system set up right the first time, so we're not fighting with it later. You know, the more we can get you set up right to begin with, then it creates less headache on us later. Alright, importing schedules. We're back to import export screen with the NASSDEF. We're putting check marks in the lock, and you've got to make sure you have to have all of these features before it's going to import this schedule. Like I said, this can be eliminated if you're on a server system, it gets eliminated totally. You're going to select import SDEF. You're going to find the TXT file. It will be a certain. You can name it whatever you want to. Whenever you do a SDEF out, it's called SDEF.txt. So you can rename it, name it however you want to name it, and then import that file. Okay. Now, this is a new feature. Right here, it says the activities don't match the CLIN values, and here's where your problems are. So it won't import that schedule. It will not import that SDEF until you fix this in Primavera and send the properly balanced schedule. So this is, it's part of the checks and balances. It's got to be accurate. It's got to be right. Okay, here's another error. This is one we were just talking about. The actual start date don't match the start and finish date reported on the daily reports. Okay, you solve that by printing that report and giving it to the scheduler before he does his payout. Okay, that's how you solve that problem. So they do match. And then also, if you haven't imported a schedule, or maybe you haven't imported your payout yet, and all of a sudden you see, you click on your pay activities and you see a red mark in here, that means your schedule's unbalanced. So that more than likely means that we've given you a modification, which made it unbalanced. And after we sign the modification, the next export comes across to you, it unbalances your pay activities immediately, because guess what? If we have a mod, you should be turning in a fragnet with every single response to an RFP to us. You are obligated to prepare a fragnet. I don't care if it does, if it doesn't affect your, if your schedule is not affected by that, that doesn't matter. Send me a fragnet anyway, because you're going to have to add some activities or something to document the dollars and the change. So you have to turn in a fragnet with every one of them as part of the scheduling spec that requires that. So you're going to turn in this fragnet, and it's your obligation to balance the CLINs, which, because it's your schedule, it's not my schedule, it's not the government's schedule, it's your schedule, it's your plan. So you have to balance them and make them work out after you've negotiated and agreed on that. Yes, sir?